receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening and welcome to Poets Pause. My name is Marilyn Klimcho. I'll be your host for this evening. And I would like to start by inviting everybody to come to First Thursday. That's held in the Goggle Works on the first Thursday of every month at 6 p.m. We usually have a featured reader, and we also have an open mic where you can share your poetry. The other event I'd like to invite you all to is Second Tuesday. We just had that last evening. That's held at Aladdin's Restaurant in West Reading, and it's an opportunity to share a meal, sit down, talk, and share poetry. And very, very informal and fun. So let me begin by describing the events that go into this evening's program. Approximately a year ago, we had a poet songwriter and performer come for Burke's Bards. Her name was Ryan Retu. I'm hoping I'm pronouncing that correctly. And she said it would be wonderful to participate in a song challenge. Shortly after that, we set up the song challenge. We said, hey, we're gonna do this in November. And after I got the entries together, I contacted her and discovered that in the meantime, she had given birth to premature twins who, from my understanding, are doing well. But there was no way that she was going to do a song challenge. Now, I'm the kind of person who cannot let that go. I could have contacted all of the contestants and said, hey, we're not doing this. I can't find anybody. But that's not quite the case. I convinced my husband to help out. He is a guitarist, not often seen in public performing.
You mean coerced, right?
Coerced, yes. So I'm going to introduce our poet, songwriter, collaborator for this song challenge this evening. His name is Patrick Klimcho. He's my husband. And one of his favorite poet songwriters is James Taylor. And it's in particular, you like Fire and Rain, because that one you can do from memory. Would you share a few lines of that with us?
Well, it's just a song he wrote. A friend of his died. And it just starts, I walked out this morning and I wrote down this song, just can't remember who to send it to.
Yeah.
It starts out, you know, just yesterday morning they let me know you were gone. You know, and the whole thing, it's a very beautiful poem. And when you put it to music, it's really extraordinary. And I think poetry today is looked a lot as something you read in a book. And in reality, it was always a performance art.
Well, and you have a particular poem that I would like you to share with the audience,
mm-hmm.
that you have written. It's not a song, but it will tell you, set the mood for what the history of song writing and song production has been like.
Well, at one First Thursday, there was a young person, and they were unfamiliar with the term bard. And I was explaining to them what it meant, and I thought, if we went back in history to the way things were done, a bard would be in a position something like this. Through the cold, dark winter's night, warrior toasts ring amongst the great hall's rafters. Flagons of ale and mead, rare and precious wine, raise hoarse shouts of raucous laughter to the crude realities of life and death. The tall old man limps to the edge of the Lord's dais. unslings his silver-stringed harp, throws back his iron-gray mane, peers out over the throng, enjoining silence with his one remaining eye. An ancient battle-tried shield man, down to the tips of his gnarled fingers where the song crier, the teller of terror and exultation begins. Hard journeys, blood and pain, implacable revenge beyond thought of Wehrgeld, interwoven lust and love and loss, desolation. The house carls are rapt, struck silent, tears flowing into the coarse beards of tried fighters born and bred. Hard hands rest upon the shoulders of remaining comrades and kinsmen, borne down and lifted up in song.
You know, and I wanted you to read that piece because it kind of sets the whole mood for where some of these songs came from and where you chose to find melodies. So when you went looking at, when you were looking at these entries, you have a repertoire that you play, and fortunately your fingers are still doing really well.
Kinda.
So you looked at these.
I just looked at this first one, and I had been playing an old folk song called Cockles and Mussels, or Molly Malone. It's an old Irish song. And I started saying these lyrics to the tune of that song, and it just fit perfectly.
And that was just, you know, one of those happy accidents at the dining room table while you were sitting there playing, and you were working beside me.
And yeah.
So maybe we could play that first tape, or do you want to take a stab at playing it yourself again?
Oh, let's let me make an absolute fool of myself and try playing it now.
Oh, he's going to play it again. Okay. And maybe we
so this poem is by Vanessa Helms. It's called Lament. And I'm putting it to the tune of an old Irish melody, Cockles and Mussels. Now, hers is about ash trees, so it's Lament. The ash trees so stately, serene boughs of greenery, have all lost their lives and been felled to the ground. Aloft in the green tops, the warblers would call out, now no more
now
shall the ash tree whisper solace to me. They've all lost their lives and been felled to the ground.
So you transpose some of those.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That was by Vanessa Helms. And thank you, Vanessa, for sending that in. She comes to us from Fredericksburg, Pennsylvania. Do you want to hear the taped piece of that?
Recall that one wasn't too bad.
Okay. So let's play that tape. We have the taped version of that, too. Mm-hmm. We came in and taped this earlier.
This is the poem Lament by Vanessa Helms, set to the tune of Cockles and Mussels, an old Irish tune. The ash trees so stately, serene boughs of greenery, have all lost their lives and been felled to the ground. Aloft in the green tops, the warblers would call out, now all is in silence, the songbirds have gone. No more shall the ash tree whisper solace to me. They've all lost their lives and been felled to the ground.
So slightly different version, but wonderful. Thank you so much. Okay. Before I get too far, because we've got a lot of tape pieces to look at, I'm going to announce the next poetry theme topic to write into, which will be the theme of First Snows. And if you can get that to me by Tuesday, December 10th, it will be read, the winning poem will be read on December 11th. So, just to move the program along, I would also like to read the winner for this month, which was to an earlier prompt, a prompt that was given to us in April. So this is by Herbert Woodward Martin, and I know you're watching. Thank you. And it's in Matisse's garden. There are voluminous colors, which had eyes that became the face that defines the borders of space. Matisse's hands were not blind to colors. They were bent with severe arthritis. In his private garden, there were shapes and colors. He was known to watch from his living room windows at the remarkable landscape. There were remarkable animals roaming the property, peacocks with rainbow colors and gray hippopotamus gliding in their wait through the forsythia, growing colorfully in his garden. He saw a snake with an apple in its mouth, a mad woolly mammoth consorting with an Egyptian camel, both uniquely welding a friendship together that would be the envy of everything that lived there, because that was how friendships were made, and it was Matisse's luck to see and record what nature was able to gift him. And that was a poem called In Matisse's Garden by Herbert Woodward Martin. Thank you so much. Okay, so let's move on to the second contestant that we have a song for, and that would be a poem by Bonnie Gardner. And I understand that Bonnie Gardner is a volunteer over at It's a Gift in Why I'm Missing. So shall we listen to the tape piece, or do you want to
talk
about this?
As I recall, the tape piece was terrible, so I probably
should prefer to do this one live. Okay.
All right. Yeah, so I looked at this song, and it has a different structure and meter, and I started saying it aloud, and all of a sudden, I was singing it to the tune of Vincent by Don McLean, Starry, Starry Night. So, as I recall, the original tape I did was horrible.
Yeah, and just to emphasize, you know, in the early years, songwriters, lyricists, people who were writing the words to music, were borrowing the same tune over and using it over.
Well, most
and over
music
again
is based on a set of chord progressions,
right,
in different keys, and you know, that's repeated over and over, and they with the different timing and different lyrics, and you know, there's been multiple lawsuits that someone plagiarized someone else's song, and they're trying to convince a judge that no, it's just this chord progression that's, you know,
That everyone uses over and over again. Okay.
All right, so this one is by Bonnie Gardner, and it just starts out. Although our time was brief, you captured my heart like a thief. If only we could change the past, maybe we could find happiness at last. Our lives drifted like the tide. No longer are we side by side. As nighttime falls, the song replays my eyes, my body in a haze. Now there's another line that really doesn't fit in with the tune all that much. It's, you know, I dream of you lying next to me. If only we were ever meant to be.
And that's a lovely song. A lot of poets, and I'm thinking of Donald Hall, the 14th U.S. Poet Laureate.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. He put in his textbook that he wrote, which was, I forget the name of it.
Pleasure of Poetry. It was one of my college texts.
The Pleasure of Poetry.
It was right after writing was invented. So
it was a new concept. So he put in some of the lyrics that were written by the Beatles, which were in our generation the group to listen to.
Mm-hmm.
And I forget which one he.
Oh, he had a list of them. I think Eleanor Rigby and I Am the Walrus and several.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he considered that poetry.
Okay. Shall we move on to the third?
Okay.
Third song challenge. Okay, this one was entered by Jeanette Guzowski, mm-hmm. and it was entitled Friend.
Now, this one, I didn't have a tune to come up with, but when I read the lyrics, Friend, where have you gone today? Smoke from your chimney yesterday made me think that you would stay. Restless soul, no heart to tame. Breezes must have called your name. That just sounded like an old blues song.
And you really, that's the song style that you are most comfortable with. In my experience,
I'm not
you
comfortable
really like,
with any of them, really.
Well, I listened to you tape it, and the taping you did of this piece.
Yeah, you want to play the tape?
Well, no, I just, and we can play the tape, mm-hmm. but you really kept going with it, and it was really good. Go ahead.
So this is called Friend. I've made a few adjustments, but. My friend, where have you gone today? Spoke from your chimney, made me think that you would stay. Restless soul, no heart can tame. Breezes must have called your name.
I'm hoping they're letting me know that we've got 10 minutes left. Is that correct?
Less, we need to do it.
Okay. So let me go really quickly to the very last one. We're going to play the tape, and then the ending of the program will be the her performance. So this is an interview that I pre-taped. Hi, so I'm also here this evening with Adbiel Gracias. That's the official name.
That is the official
but
name.
But your stage name is Bee HiveQueen.
Yes, ma'am.
And welcome to the program.
Thank you
it's
for
so
having
nice
me.
To have you on Poets Pause. And you were so cooperative in helping me with this song challenge. I absolutely owe you my firstborn, my secondborn, my thirdborn. However many children I have, they're yours. So talk to me about what you thought when you started to approach this piece.
Well, actually, when you gave me the piece, the first thing I did was read it over a couple times because I wanted to try to get the sense of what the writer was trying to depict, and in looking it over, it seemed like a twisted fairy tale.
I read this piece. It's by Nicole Fix.
Yes, Nicole Fix, The Escape Clause.
Yes, and I was just like, I can't give this to my husband. He likes folk songs. He likes blues. He is in no way capable of really doing it justice. And yet I found myself drawn back to it. And I thought of you, and I said, you would be the best person to interpret something that is this close to spoken word, mm-hmm. This close to rap, mm-hmm. this close to anger, this close to a volcanic emotion.
Yes, I saw that, and I loved the way that she expressed Cinderella is her own person.
Yes, Cinderella is not sitting there being
crying crying.
I need my husband. I need a prince.
She gets on her motorcycle and takes off.
Yes, she does.
So wonderful. And so I really enjoyed that aspect of the piece. Mm-hmm. And I love that it was a gift from her grandmother, that it's not some guy that gave her a bike, that it was in the family, and then she decided to just take off.
She inherits her own freedom.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
She takes charge of that, and then she takes it, and she goes. And I love that aspect. And the music that I chose to go with the piece, mm-hmm. it's kind of like an edgier statement on, look, I'm me and I'm my own person.
Right.
So that's why I chose the music that I picked.
So, and my husband did this too. He found material that was already written musically, mm-hmm. because he's played music a long time, so he adapted the lyrics for can't remember, but it was a folk song, mm-hmm. you know what I mean, and then he found a parallel in modern song. You know, something that's been on the radio that's popular, and I understand that that's what you've done as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I and that was original. The funny thing is, the piece that I picked to accompany this written mm-hmm. Art is a folk song. It used to be a folk song.
Tell me, because I didn't know that.
Yes, You Don't Own Me originally came out a couple of decades ago.
Okay.
And it was a smoother, more rambunctious anthem
for
women's lib.
Right.
And then it got revamped recently into this edgy, women are taking over the world type of piece.
Mm-hmm.
So I like to listen to the original and then the new remix and compare the two. And I think with this piece, with the edge and the newness, I chose the remix, the newer version,
mm-hmm.
with a nod to the older.
So did you find yourself altering the words that were given to you?
I tried to keep it as true to what the writer wrote as possible. I didn't want to change her words, and I didn't want to change her lyrics because I wanted her to know that what she put out there was acceptable.
Was good.
It was acceptable.
See, my husband had the same issue. You know, I was going like, you can alter this. You can change this if you need to adjust the beat. And they were all going like, no.
No.
Like,
it's not my piece. It's not my piece to alter.
I'm like,
It's not my piece to alter. I will work with it. I will play with music, the melody, the cadence. But the words themselves, that is what Nicole wanted to put forth. So I'm not going to take it away from her.
See, now Karen Retiru said that she would take them as inspiration,
mm-hmm.
not, and that she would take it in whatever direction she felt she wanted to go. So I think that aspect of the song challenge has gone by the wayside, whether that was a good idea or a bad idea, it doesn't matter. It's just that the people who have taken on this challenge musically have said, I don't want to violate what the author put down.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's being true and honest to their work.
Right.
Because if one of my pieces was given to a songwriter for them to perform, I wouldn't want my lyrics changed.
Really?
I wouldn't, unless I gave the permission.
Right.
If I came to you and you decided you liked one of my pieces and you were gonna put it to music, I don't expect you to change my words.
See, I would expect my words to be changed if the performer says, hey, this part doesn't work for me, I need to alter it to go with a rhythm. So I would expect it to change, but that's because I think I must approach writing from a different perspective.
But that would be more of a collaboration, because the artist would be coming to you and saying, hey, this doesn't work, how about we change the lyrics? I haven't met Nicole. I haven't spoken to her about the piece. We haven't discussed it. So because of that, I didn't feel that it was my right to change her lyrics.
So you want to respect her writing?
Yes.
Well, that is wonderful.
This is Song Challenge from the poem The Escape Clause by Nicole Fix. I thought that it was a good choice because of the compilation of a twisted fairy tale. You don't own me.
one of your many toys. You don't own me. Don't say I can't go with other. You don't own me. I'm not just one of your many toys. You don't own me. Don't say I can't go with other.
Speaking of accessories, Cinderella grabbed the slippers. Matching pair, never intending to implicate herself 1 second longer than necessary. That girl skipped tea time, burned her book and asphalt, kicked the curb, kicked the asphalt, threw down the throttle of the baby sleek Kawasaki W650, her stepmother said. And I miss you like crazy, present along with the eye candy, snuggled at her back, and glass.
You don't own me.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.